Good morning, students. Welcome to the lecture of real analysis 1. In the last lecture, we have started with the properties of the functions having non-zero Jacobian determinant. And under this, we have seen an important theorem. Okay. The statement of this theorem tells us that, in short, if I want to write, if we have a continuous function having all partial derivatives for the given function, where the Jacobian determinant is non-zero, provided with a small condition that fx is not equal to fa for all the points on the boundary of the ball, then we have proved that f of b, that is the image of b under f, contains an n ball with center at f of a. This is the sketch. This is an n ball. Sorry, this is the n ball in the domain space with center at a, radius r. And if f satisfies all those conditions, then we have proved the f image of this ball. Now, f image of this ball, that is a sphere, not necessarily be a sphere. It depends on your function. Therefore, arbitrarily, we have drawn one sketch, which is no doubt a subset of Rn space. Okay. Then this is, in this, what we wanted to prove? We wanted to prove that this f image of the open ball, that is f of b, again, this contains an open ball whose center is at f of a. That is, if a is the center of b, we have proved that f of b contains an open ball whose center is at f of a. To prove this theorem, actually, we have done some two, three constructions. In the first step, we have made the construction of a function g, where this function g we have taken to be a distance between fx and f of a for a point x. Here is the point. For x is a point on the boundary of this open ball, we have taken f of x somewhere here. Then initially we have defined g to be a distance between fx and fa, which gives us g is positive. If g is positive, defined on a compact set, therefore g is bounded, therefore minimum exists. We have assumed the minimum of g of x is m, and it exists for some point z on the boundary. Then later we have drawn an open sphere centered at f of a with radius less than m. Particularly, it was taken to be m by 2. Then, in order to prove that this t is contained in f of b, we have started with one vector y. In order to prove that this y is in f of b, we have constructed a new function again, which is actually a distance between f of x and y. Also, we have proved that this h is having its minima because it is continuous, defined on a compact space. Again, it has minima, and we have shown that the minima is of inside the open ball, not on the boundary. This we have proved. If h is having its minima inside the ball, we have written that h square is also having the minima. Why we have written h square? Because h of x is taken to be a distance between fx and y, and if by the distance formula, this is the distance with the square root on the right hand side. Therefore, just to make the calculation simpler, we have taken h square. Therefore, h square is minima at the same point, we have assumed. Then using the extrema condition, for all partial derivatives are zero, which gives us the system of simultaneous linear equations, n equations in n variables, where we have seen that this system will possess a trivial solution. Possessing a trivial solution gives us frc is minus yr is equal to 0, proving y is equal to f of c. Actually, we have started with y is a point in t, and we have proved that y is in f of b, proving the result that f of b contains an open ball centered at f of a. This is what just a theme. For every theorem, for every proof of the theorem, you have to prepare a theme like this. Once you remember the theme, no need to write all the steps. No need to by heart all the steps. Okay. What I'm going to do before going to the next point of this, let me just write the statement of the theorem in short and what is the conclusion. This is actually theorem number 2 we have seen. How many conditions are given? B bar is given with ball with its boundary, and no doubt it's a compact set. Then f, no doubt to be an n-tuple vector, a vector valued function, f1, f2, 2. Fn, this is continuous on b bar. This is continuous on b bar and has finite partial derivatives. Has finite partial derivatives means partial derivatives exist. Okay, correct, na? Both the meaning is same. Having the finite value of all the partial derivatives, or one can say partial derivatives exist. Then it was given that Jacobian determinant of this function at the point x is not equal to 0 for all the points on the boundary. for all the points on the, sorry, for all the points in B, not on the boundary. Similarly, f of x is not equal to f of a for all the points on the boundary. All the points on the boundary means x is not equal to a, na? Because a is the center of the sphere. This is my b, a is the center, and this is the boundary. Therefore, if I am taking x to be the points on the boundary, means these x are not equal to a. Therefore, for x not equal to, f of x is not equal to a. Therefore, actually, this condition is telling us that f is 1, 1 on the boundary. Correct, na? This condition is very similar to f is 1, 1 on the boundary. And if any function satisfies all these conditions, what we have proved, that the f of b contains, what we have proved? F of b contains an n ball centered at f of a. This is what the theorem we have seen in the last lecture. Now let me go to the next point of this today's lecture. In this lecture we were going to understand the first definition of an open mapping. Can anyone know? Do anyone know this open mapping definition? Okay, definition is actually easy. Mapping is said to be an open mapping if it takes open sets to open sets. That is, F image of open set is open in its codomain. Let me write the definition. A function F defined from S to T from one matrix space. From one matrix space, yes, DS. What is this DS stands for? DS is the metric defined on S to another T, DT. DT is the metric defined on T, is called an open mapping. Is called an open mapping if for every open set in A, if for every open set in A, comma, the image, what will be the image of this from A under F? Is it F of A? The image F of A is open in T. Okay, it takes, or one can say that function maps open sets to open sets for our sake of understanding. Function maps open sets to open set. Okay, now whatever the next theorem we were trying to study, that theorem gives us the sufficient condition for the mapping to carry open sets onto open sets. Let me write the statement of this theorem. Let me come to the next page. This is theorem number 3. Let me write the statement. Let capital A be an open subset of Rn. Open subset of Rn, and assume f is defined from A to Rn. What kind of function it is? May I say the function is of the type Rn to Rn? Correct, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Function type is Rn to Rn, defined from A to Rn. Is continuous and has finite partial derivatives. Now here it was given having finite partial derivative. What does it mean? Partial derivatives exist, no? As finite partial derivatives dj fi on A. Okay. Then if f is 1 to 1 that is 1 1, 1 1 on A, and if Jacobian determinant is not equal to 0 for each x in A, for each x in A, then prove that, then prove that f of A is open. Okay, look at the statement. How many conditions are given? A is given to be an open subset of the domain of, open subset of the Rn, which works as the domain. Okay, function is given to be continuous, having all partial derivatives also, and Jacobian determinant is non-zero. Function is 1 to 1. Then our aim is to prove that f of A is open. For an open subset in Rn, we were proving the f image of this is open. Okay, therefore actually this was a condition for an open mapping theorem. We just want to use this previous theorem. How many conditions are there in the previous theorem? Function continuous, having finite partial derivative, Jacobian determinant non-zero, and this condition. If we look at this condition for x not equal to a, it implies fx is not equals to fa, proving that f is 1 to 1, that is 1 1 on dou b. Now, whatever the theorem we have written just now, it satisfies all the conditions of the previous theorem. Now, that's why one can use the previous theorem statement in order to prove this result. Okay, now how should we prove that f of a is open? Provided a is open, what is the meaning of the set A is open? Since A is open, what can I write? Since A is open subset of Rn, what can I write?
F of A contains open ball.
No, actually, what I'll do, I'll start with what we want to prove. I want a definition of an open set. What is the definition of open set? Yes? Here we want to prove that f of a is open, no? Prove that f of a is open. What should I prove f of a is open means? Every point in that set is an interior point. Interior point means what? If I start with an arbitrary point in that set, then there exists a small neighborhood around the point contained in this f of a. This is what we should prove, no? Therefore, if I start with some b point is in f of a, b point is in f of a, then may I write b is equal to f of a, for some small a in capital A? Is this point clear? We want to prove f of a is open. That is, for every point in f of a, our aim is to show that this point is an interior point. That is, it will contain, that f of a will contain a small neighborhood around the given point. Now, we were going to start with a point b in f of a. If b is in f of a, what does it mean? B is equal to f of a, right? Let me write here. Let me draw one sketch to understand. Let this be a subset A of an Rn space, okay? Corresponding f of a, no doubt, will be a subset of an Rn space again. Now we have started with a point b in f of a, where no doubt b is equal to f of a, correct? Now, because it is the member of the range set f of a, so b is equal to f of a. In order to prove this b to be an interior point, what one has to prove? There exists a small neighborhood around this point B, which is contained in f of a. This is what we want to prove. Therefore, for this A, as we have written B is equal to f of a, this small a must be an element of A, element of capital A. But what is A given to us? This is an open set. This is an open set. If this capital A is an open set, what can I say about this small a point? This is an interior point. If it is an interior point, what can I write? I can say
there exists neighborhood.
Yes, good. There exists a neighborhood around this point A, and let us denote it as with B of A comma R. Correct, no? V of A comma R. Is this point clear to everyone? This
Yes,
B of AR
ma'am.
is contained in A. This B of AR is contained in A. Now, one can say that the by using the previous theorem, what about this F image of this open ball B? F image of open ball. F image of
there
open
is F of A.
I repeat, repeat. F image of this open ball B.
Having center F of A.
No. Contains an open ball centered at F of A. Correct, na?
Yes, ma'am.
Therefore, what is the F image of this B I am writing? See, I am writing this by F of B, say. I am writing this as F of B. Okay, and by the previous theorem, this F image of B, that is F of B, contains an open ball centered at F of A. No doubt, if B is contained in A, what about F of B? F of B is contained in F of A, and this F of B contains an open ball centered at F of A with some radius r dash, say. May I say this point B that is equal to F of A is an interior point of F of A, and hence the proof. Getting me or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Therefore, let me write it. Here we have written, if B is equal to F of A, then B is equal, B belongs to F of A, then B is equal to F of A for some small A is in A. Now, since A is open subset, may I write this B of A comma R is contained in A? A is in A, no? A is the point in A. Capital A is open. Therefore, this small a must be an interior point of the given set. That's why we are writing B of AR is contained in A. Now, let me write. Now, F satisfies all the hypotheses of previous theorem. All hypotheses of previous theorem. What is the number? 2, I think, no? Previous theorem number 2. Okay, therefore, what it implies? F image of this B contains an open ball, centered at F of A is equal to B, can I write? Centered at F of A is equal to B. Therefore, may I say now this B equal to F of A is an interior point of the set? Is an interior point of F of A. If B is an interior point, may I say F of A is open? Hence the proof of this theorem. Any doubt with this? Yes, from student side, if you have any doubts, you can ask me. Already we have seen that it satisfies all the hypothesis of the previous theorem. This one-to-one condition gives that x not equals to a implies x not equals to a gives me f of x is equal to a. Correct, no? Like this. That is f is 1-1 on dou b. Here it is given f is 1-1 on a. Therefore, we have proved this theorem by using the previous theorem. Any difficulty with this?
No, ma'am.
Good. Let me go for a next theorem, number 4. Now, this theorem is actually given as the condition for 1-1 function. Condition for 1-1 function. Previous is giving us the function to be open mapping. Assume that F is an interpol vector F1, F2, to Fn has continuous partial derivatives DJFI, DJFI on an open set S in Rn. Can anyone tell me the nature of the function then? From this, what kind
Rn
of function?
To Rn.
Yes, it is the function from Rn to RnA type. Why? Because F is defined to be an n-tuple vector, okay? And it is defined on open set S in Rn itself. Correct, na? Open set S in Rn. Next, and the Jacobian determinant is non-zero. If you observe, this condition is everywhere in this theorem, because we were studying the properties of non-zero Jacobian determinant. The Jacobian determinant JF at the point A is not equals to zero for some point A in S. Then prove that there is an n ball. Then prove that there is an n ball BA on which F is 1-1. See what it is asked to prove us. Function is of the type Rn to Rn, having all partial derivatives, defined on an open set. Also, Jacobian determinant is given to be non-zero at some point A of the domain. Then we want to prove that there exists an n-ball around that A, B of A we have written, and we have to prove that this function is 1-1. What one has to prove for the function to be 1-1? Yes? What one has to prove for the function to be 1-1? Yes, students. Hello? Am I audible or not?
Different elements are different.
Yes, ma'am.
Different elements
are? F of x is equals to f of a.
F of x equal to f of a? Different elements have different images. What is the methodology we have used to prove? What is the methodology we have used to prove this f to be 1-1? F is 1-1. How we have proved it? Taking x not equals to y, we have proved fx is not equals to fy, no? In the basic itself, we have discussed. Actually, the definition is different elements having different images. Correct, no? Different elements have different images. We want to prove this statement in the function. Now, in order to prove this function, it was a particular case considered in order to prove that Jacobian determinant is non-zero on sum. It was given to be non-zero at the point. Now we want to elaborate, or we want to extend it to be non-zero on some neighborhood of this point A, that is B of A. And to do so, it was defined with a new function H, which is actually a determinant. For that purpose, the function was taken, or it is taken on an Rn square space. Let me write how. Actually, we were considering n points, z1, z2 to be zn, bn points in S. Bn points in S, where S is the subset of Rn. If I am considering all these are the points in Rn, may I say every vector itself is an n-tuple vector? If every vector itself is an n-tuple vector, we have taken such n points. Therefore, how many coordinates in all we have in our hand? Is it n cross n? N square coordinates will be there, no? Okay, and we will define this to be a one point. And let z is equal to, we are going to define this to be z1, z2 to be zn, denote the points in Rn square. This is the point in Rn square whose first n coordinates are components of z1, correct na? Whose n coordinates are components of z1. Next n coordinates are, whose next n coordinates are components of z2 and so on. Next n coordinates are components of z2. Components of z2 and so on. Okay, try to get me. Z1, z2 itself are the points in Rn space. We have collected such n vectors. We have written a point, new point z to be an n-tuple vector of these. Every vector itself is n-tuple. We have collected it. Therefore, there are in all n square coordinate, where the first n coordinates are components of z1. Next n coordinates are components of z2. Next n again will be the components of z3 and so on. Therefore, it will be the member of Rn square. Whatever this new point z we have defined will be a member of Rn square space. Now, with the help of this, we were going to define a real value function h, which is actually determinant of partial derivatives, that is determinant, Jacobian determinant. Okay, define a real valued function. Define a real valued function h as, how I'm going to define h as, h of z is equal to determinant dj fi at the point zi, no doubt zi is in Rn space. Zi belongs to Rn. Whatever this Jacobian determinant, we are calling this as h of z. And how many and this function, what this function is going to have, how many entries it will have? N cross n matrix it will be,
right? N cross n.
Yes, this function is continuous at those points z in Rn square where h of z is defined. Where h of z is defined because dj fi are continuous. Dj fi are continuous on S and its determinant is a polynomial. May I write in n square entries? Polynomial in its n square entries, correct? No, whenever we were writing a 2 cross 2 matrix, it will create a polynomial with 4 entries. No, for here it will have in all n square entries, it's a polynomial. Therefore, this function, as it is a polynomial in n square entries, we are writing continuous because we know every polynomial is continuous. Is the point clear? This function, whatever we have defined h to be determinant of this partial derivatives, that is Jacobian determinant we have defined, and this function is going to be continuous at those points in Rn square where h of z is defined. If it is defined, it is continuous. Why it is continuous? Because all these partial derivatives are also continuous and are defined. Therefore, the determinant is going to create a polynomial in n square entry, knowing every polynomial is continuous. This h becomes a continuous function. And what is one more hint given to us? Jacobian determinant is not equal to zero for a point A. Therefore, if I put a point zi is equal to A here, then this gives me h of A is not equals to zero. Therefore, let us select z be a point. Let z be a spatial point in Rn square obtained by putting, I'm going to put z is A, by putting z1 is equal to z2 is equal to dot dot up to zn is equal to A. all zi is equal to a we have substituted, then what this above equation becomes? May I write this is equal to h of a, which is, this will actually create determinant dj fi at the point a, which is nothing but Jacobian determinant at the point a, and we know it is not equals to zero. It was given Jacobian determinant is not equals to zero. Now focus on the point h is continuous and having a non-zero value at some point a. H is continuous having a non-zero value at some point in a, then may I say there exists a small neighborhood around a on which h is non-zero again, on which h is non-zero again. Let us try to understand this by a simple sketch. Suppose this is my continuous function in an R2 space, and at this point, say a, the function is given to be non-zero, correct na? This is non-zero na, because it is having this point is located above x-axis, therefore it is having a non-zero value, rather a positive value it will have. And as this function is continuous, may I locate some neighborhood around a? May I locate some neighborhood around a on which still the function is given to be non-zero? Correct na? Still the function is non-zero. However small a sketch, however close the curve is to x-axis, still we will get the same conclusion, correct na? Suppose this is the point A I have selected, where the curve is very close to x-axis. Okay, therefore again, can I find out a small neighborhood in which the function is having a non-zero value? This is one of the properties of the continuous function. Now here also we have seen that h is continuous, correct na? Where the function is continuous and h of a is not equals to zero, therefore one can claim there exists a small neighborhood around b on which h of a is non-zero again. Therefore here we can write, hence by continuity, there is some n ball. What is the neighborhood on n dimensional space? It's an n ball na? A neighborhood in an R2 space is an interval, right? We are discussing in an Rn space, therefore it's an open ball. We are calling it as an n ball B of A, such that, what such that? Determinant dj fi at the point zi is not equal to zero for zi belongs to B of A. And let me call this as statement number one. Now, in order to obtain this Jacobian determinant, this is Jacobian determinant at the point zi, no? Is equal to, is non-zero for some neighborhood around B. To prove this, we have defined this h to be a function on an Rn square space, which will actually create one polynomial in n square entries. And we know every polynomial is a continuous function. And using that continuity, we have written that the Jacobian determinant is non-zero for some neighborhood of this point. Now here is the one part of the theorem. Now let us start with the second part of the theorem. Now in the second part, we are going to prove the required result. Actually, that is, we want to prove that f is 1-1. In order to prove f is 1-1, we will start with x not equal to y, and we will prove that fx is not equal to fy is the aim. But here we will start with a contradictory assumption. What is the contradictory assumption?
F of x equal to f of y, then x equal to y.
No. For x not equal to y, we have to assume f of x is equal to f of y. Correct, na? Our aim is to show that this f of a is 1-1 on b of a. And we have done that if on this B of A, Jacobian determinant is non-zero. Okay. Now, actually, in order to prove this, f is 1-1, we want to prove x not equal to y implies fx is not equal to fy. Now, we will make the contradictory assumption. What we wanted to prove, fx not equal to fy. Therefore, we will assume fx equal to y as a contradictory assumption. But assume that assume the contradiction that f of x is equal to f of y for some points x not equals to y in B of A. Is this point clear? Contradictory assumption. Our aim is to prove f of x is not equals to f of y for x not equal to y. Therefore, we were assuming f of x is equal to f of y for some x not equals to. Now, as it was a contradictory assumption, in order to prove the result, somewhere we should get the contradiction. Now, we are going to prove the second part of the theorem with the help of a mean value theorem. I think you were remembering what is mean value theorem for an multivariable function. In order to use mean value theorem, one should consider for any two points x, y, the line joining the two points is in the same space. But what is this B of A? B of A is actually an open sphere, no? B of A is actually an open sphere where x and y are the two points. If you consider the sphere in a three-dimensional space also, and if x and y are the two points, what about the line segment? If I join the two points with a line segment, may I say the line segment is in B of A? Yes or no? Yes, it is. And actually, this is one of the property, or it was said to be, it was defined to be a convex set. What is a convex set? Line segment joining any two points, if it is in the same set, the set is said to be a convex set. Now, here we are going to write, since B of A is convex set, what is convex set? Line segment joining any two points of the set, lies in the same set. Therefore, as it is an open sphere, no doubt this is going to be a convex set. Therefore, may I write the line segment? What is the symbol we have used for the line segment notation? Is it L of xy? L of xy is contained in B of A. Correct now? Now let us use the mean value theorem. Now the mean value theorem we will use for the coordinate functions of F. How we have defined F? F we have defined to be F1, F2 to Fn. Now we are using this mean value theorem for this coordinate function. What is the behavior of this coordinate function? Is it a function defined on Rn, but it's a real valued function, correct now? This is the real valued function. That is, the nature of that function is of Rn to R type. Okay. Now, if Rn to R type, what is the derivative of the function? What is the nature of the derivative? Scalar, vector, matrix.
Scalar.
Rn to R, I'm asking.
Gradient. Gradient.
Yes, it is a gradient vector, because in mean value theorem we have to write its derivative, no? Therefore, let me write by mean value theorem to each component of F. To each component of F, we write for y and x, we are writing f I y minus f I x is equals to f dash of z I into y minus x. And this is for I equals to 1 to n. Na? Getting me the statement. What is the statement of original theorem? F y minus f x is equals to f dash of z into y minus x. Now, simply as we are writing for fi, okay, for fi coordinate function we were writing, that's why I have changed this point zi, z to zi, where this zi lies on the line segment joining. Yes, zeta lies on the line segment joining. Yes, correct. Where zi belongs to L of xy. Therefore, may I write zi belongs to B of A? Because line segment joining x and y is in B of A. Therefore, zi is also is in B of A. Okay. Now, in the next step, what we will do? What is the left hand side value? As we were assuming fx is equal to fy, let me call it as statement number 2. Say, if fx is equal to fy, what about the coordinate wise values? Fi y and fi x. May I say they are same? Therefore, what is the value of my left hand side? It is 0. 0 f dash. Okay. Now, f dash of z I am going to substitute as gradient vector. Therefore, may I write? This is del fi. Del fi zi into y minus x. Here reason from 2, fx is equal to fy. Therefore, if we write coordinate wise, this gives us fi x is equal to fi y for I equals to 1 to n. Correct, no? Coordinate wise equality, one can say. Okay. And why this MVT is applicable? Because it was given that this function is having finite partial derivatives. Let me call this as statement number 3. What is statement number 3? We have obtained del fi zi into y minus x. Now again, we were going to say that this 3 generates a system of equations. Why? Because for every I, it will give us one equation. It will give us one equation. Then what kind of system it will create? Let us have a look. What is the, I'll just change the color of my pen. Okay. What is del fi zi? Can anyone tell me? Del fi zi? Gradient vector. If it is fx, y, I don't know how many times I have to tell this. What is del f? Dou f by dou x. Dou f by dou y. Do you know the geometrical interpretation of gradient vector? I will not go to this point. What is del fi zi? All partial derivatives I have to write now. D1 fi zi. D2 fi zi. Is it okay or not? If you have a difficulty, you can stop me and ask any at any stage. Now, what I'm explaining you, this 3 generates a system of linear equations. This is a system of linear equations. And we are going to discuss about linear equations as. I hope I am clearly audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Y1 minus x1. Now, y and x are the two vectors in an n-dimensional space. What about their coordinates? May I write the respective subtraction of their coordinates? First coordinate will be y1 minus x1. Second coordinate, say, y2 minus x2. And nth coordinate will be yn minus xn. Right? Then what is the dot product of these two vectors? Del fi zi into y minus x. What will be a dot product? D1 fi zi into y1 minus x1 plus D2 fi zi into y2 minus x2. Continue up to dn fi zi into yn minus xn. Okay, let me write it in the summation form. This is, say, summation k equals to 1 to n dk fi zi into yk minus xk. Is it okay? See, whatever the system I am telling you, this is not given in any book. It was directly given. It generates a system of linear equations. It will possess the solution as with so-so condition and all. Right? Now, what we will do? whatever is this value, okay, we will substitute as some aik. Put aik is equal to dk fi zi. Therefore, what kind of equation it will be? Del fi zi minus y minus x is equal to summation k equals to 1 to n aik yk minus xk. Aik yk minus xk. Correct, na? But now what this equation number? What is the number we have given? 3, na? Okay, now let me write 3. What this 3 becomes? With this explanation, now one can say what is this 3? Now thus 3 becomes. Let me come in a green pen again. Therefore, may I write this del fi zi, that is summation k equals to 1 to n aik yk minus xk is equal to 0. Aik is equal to dk fi zi. Okay, now this is the system of linear equations, na? N linear equations. Okay, I forgot to write the equations. Which are the variables in this?
Yk minus xk.
Good. Therefore, may I write, thus this is a system of linear homogeneous equations in n variables. What are the n variables? Y1 minus x1, y2 minus x2, so on, yn minus xn. And now what about its coefficient matrix? All partial derivatives, no? What is the coefficient matrix? Aik it is. That is, Aik is all partial derivatives. Correct, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Here I will write the matrix. Coefficient matrix. What is the coefficient matrix? For first k equal to 1, we will write d1 f1 zf. K equal to 1, first equation. Okay, in this, we were going to substitute for all k and I equals to 1 to n. Correct? Now I am writing for I equals to 1 and running up the summation. What will be the first equation? Instead of coefficient matrix, shall I give you the equations? What is the system of equation is going to be? D1 F1 ZI, D2 F1 ZI, so on. Oh, sorry. Variables I forgot. System of equations we will write. Summation dj, sorry, dk, na? Dk fi zi k equals to 1 to n yk minus xk is equal to 0 and I is equals to 1 to n. What is the first value for I equals to 1? Function will be f1, and just we have to run up the sum. First term, d1 f1 zi y1 minus x1 plus d2 f1 zi y2 minus x2, so on, dn f1 zi yn minus xn is equal to 0. This is the first equation. What for I equals to 2? d1 f2 zi plus d2 f2 zi y2 minus x2, so on, dn f2zi yn minus xn is equal to 0. Correct, no? What for I equals to n? This is d1 fn zi y1 minus x1 plus d2 fn zi y2 minus x2, so on dn fn zi yn minus xn is equal to 0. This is what a system is being created where the variables used are y1 minus x1, y2 minus x2 to yn minus xn. What is the coefficient matrix? Coefficient matrix is the collection of these partial derivatives, no? First row is all partial derivatives of f1. Second row, partial derivatives of f2. Nth row, partial derivatives of fn. Therefore, may I say whatever is the coefficient matrix? Coefficient matrix is nothing but the Jacobian matrix?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And if it is so, the system is of the type determinant A, matrix A into X. Matrix A into matrix X is equal to 0. Now, when this system is going to possess the solution? Yesterday we have seen, no?
Determinant A not equal to 0.
Now, what is A here? Jacobian matrix. But do you know whether Jacobian determinant is non-zero at this point? Yes, from statement number 1. We have already written first part of the theorem. Jacobian determinant at the point zi is not equal to 0 for zi to be the points in B of A. Here also we were studying for the points in B of A, no? The discussion is for all the points in B of A. Therefore, whatever is zi we have taken is a point on the line joining x and y, and no doubt it is point of the this B of A, that ball. Okay, so for this point, we know already Jacobian determinant is non-zero. Therefore, the system is going to possess a trivial solution, no? X is equal to 0. Means all the variables are 0. Correct? All the variables are 0 means yk equal to xk. Yk equal to xk for all k equal to 1 to n, which gives you y equal to x. Hence, it is the contradiction. Correct, na? Here, let me call this is 4. Okay, now what we are going to write now? Since zi belongs to B of A, comma, the determinant of coefficient matrix, the determinant of coefficient matrix of this system. What is the determinant of coefficient matrix?
Jacobian matrix.
Yes, this is Jacobian determinant. Determinant of the coefficient matrix, that is Jacobian determinant, is non-zero by equation number 1. Right? And if the determinant of coefficient matrix is non-zero, what should I rewrite? The system possesses trivial solution. The system possesses a trivial solution. What is the meaning of trivial solution? All the variables are zero. Correct? What are the variables here?
Yk minus xk. Yk minus xk.
Good. Therefore, yk minus xk is equal to 0 for k equals to 1 to n. For k equals to 1 to n. Therefore, may I say the vector y is equal to x. Okay, that is x is equal to y. But what we have started with an assumption, for x not equal to y, we have assumed fx is equal to y. Therefore, this is a contradiction. This is a contradiction to an assumption. This is the contradiction to assumption x not equal to y. Hence, the assumption is wrong. What is the wrong assumption we have made then? Therefore, we have the wrong assumption we have made is actually for x not equal to y, we have taken fx is equal to fy. Therefore, what we have now, x not equals to y implies fx is not equal to fy. Hence, the function is 1, 1. Function is 1, 1. On which space it was 1, 1? This is 1, 1 on B of A. This is 1, 1 on B of A. Therefore, what this theorem clearly tells us, if we have Jacobian determinant is non-zero at some point, then in its neighborhood, provided with those conditions, no doubt, the function is 1, 1 on in its neighborhood. Okay. This is what the proof of the theorem is. If you have any difficulty, you can ask. Yes, students, if you have any difficulties, you can ask me. This is the fourth theorem we have completed today. Now, we remains with only 4 to 5 theorems. Yes, if you are not having any difficulty, let us stop for today then. Let us stop for today. Thank you for being with me for this lecture.